Now joining us for our company call this morning is another member of the Ayala Group of Companies, Mr. Arthur Tan, President of Integrated Microelectronics, the semiconductor arm of Ayala. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Warren.
All right, thank you for joining us this morning.
Pleasure.
Let's talk about first the first quarter results. Your sales up close to 9% and compared to what you did last year, up 15%. And then your profit, though, there was a bit of a disappointment there. Take us through what happened.
Well, basically, one of the things that happened was that our forecasted revenue that's going to come out from predominantly a stable economy like China didn't materialize for the first quarter. So actually, the downturn in China, the slowing down of the Chinese economy actually manifested itself during the first quarter. We were able to make up for some of the difference with our European and the Philippine operations, which actually performed better than forecast, but not enough to circumvent our 45% revenue generation that comes out of China.
Right. And speaking of the semiconductor industry in general, you look at our exports in the first quarter, very poor, down three consecutive months. But we were talking earlier, your component from exporting out of the Philippines is not really a big chunk of your operation.
Yes, well, the Philippines actually comprise about a quarter of our revenue base. And from a Philippine electronics market perspective, right, although there has been a significant drop in the export numbers of 30%, the overall global semiconductor market actually only decreased by 1%. So it's actually a manifestation of the type of products that's actually being produced and manufactured, shipped out of the Philippines from an overall semiconductor market in the Philippines vis-a-vis the total economic semiconductor market. So it's just a matter of which markets and sub-markets that's being supplied to by the local manufacturers as compared to the global electronic market.
And also you were saying earlier, it also depends on the kind of product that you offer as a semiconductor company. You were saying a lot of our exporters here, they're only manufacturing the chips, the semicons, and you're actually on a higher chair with regards to the supply system where you're actually assembling.
Well, different parts of the food chain. Mm-hmm. So 70% of the manufacturers, electronic manufacturers in the country, is tied towards the semiconductor part. And about 30% is similar to what IMI is, that builds more of the subsystems towards the end of the product. Now, that 30% that's comprised of the semiconductor business in the Philippines are tied mostly to the smartphone, computing, and as you know, the tablet business is driving a lot of the downturn in the use of components and subcomponents compared to a laptop or a full laptop and a desktop. And so that's where we see some of the transition in the electronic market.
So to put it simply, you are catering to the specific needs of your clients, and that's why you're actually able to grow your revenues in the first quarter.
Yeah.
Yeah, so let's talk again about the bottom line, though. One of the reasons you mentioned for the decline in profit was the actual underutility of your China facilities.
Right.
So what happens now? Are you going to try to mitigate the losses being suffered there, but maybe a closure?
Actually, the forecast going into the second quarter, it's a timing perspective of some of the projects that we've been doing has taken up a slower pace in taking up the new products. But we see the second quarter being able to recover from our China operation. So we see a better China performance for the second quarter. The Philippines and the European operations continue to see a robust and new growing technology. So on an overall basis, towards the end of the year, we're still seeing a meeting of our forecast for the end of the year numbers.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about demand. You mentioned that there's been a tapering off demand in China, but what's your outlook for the rest of the year? We've actually been talking about this with other semicon members. In general, in the global economy, we've noticed that the semicon is actually sort of improving from last year.
Yeah.
But our exports aren't really aren't really keeping up. And you mentioned it again; it all has to do with the products. Again, how's demand in general?
Demand in general is picking up. The U.S. economy is stabilizing and it's recovering, so we're seeing an uptick on that front. The European market, although it has some fiscal problems, I think are being able to manage that. And so the largest component of the consuming market is still going to be Asia, driven by China. And with China forecasting a 7% GDP growth, I think we'll then pull everybody else, including the Philippines. As you know, the consuming market in the Philippines is also growing. So from that perspective, I see that the overall performance for 2013 will be better than what 2012 was.
And you also mentioned that the emergence of the tablet also eating into right. your production for other gadgets. Are you right. looking into that segment also?
Well, we have some, we are in the storage technology business. And so if you look at it from a tablet perspective, you don't have an optical disk drive, you don't have a hard drive, that's all semiconductor-based drives. And so that's the part that's actually diminishing. However, we're heavily into automotive, but likewise, and industrial. And so those two product lines are still growing considerably across the world. And so we're seeing some uptick in, and our forecast is holding on to that.
Do you have a revenue mix for that?
A revenue mix right now, for the first quarter, 38% of our business is actually automotive and about 16% industrial. So majority of our business is already transitioned away from the PC computing market and more so into the automotive industrial market.
And the outlook for those sectors are?
Are still very good. Still very good. Even though the overall number for automotive vehicles globally is going to be in the high single digits, the electronic content that's going to go into these vehicles are in the double digits.
Yeah, okay. And of course, with regards to your dealings, we're going to have to talk about the peso, foreign exchange, yeah. very volatile. Right. The peso strengthening significantly against right. the dollar, although lately it's weakened slightly.
Yes.
How has that affected your operations?
Well, it affected us because, like I said, a quarter of our revenue is Philippine-based. Although we have some natural hedges to that. But overall, we also deal in renminbi as we also deal in euro. And so overall, the peso is actually hurting us two ways. One is the stronger peso that's just affecting everybody here. And the other one is because it's tied also that in spite of a stronger peso, we did not see a diminished energy cost. As in the past, it was tied together that the reason for the higher energy cost was because of the weak peso. And now we have a strong peso, and still we're still paying one of the highest in terms of electricity cost
right, so
in the region.
Right, feeling the benefit. Yeah, exactly.
We're not seeing the benefits. Right.
All right. Last question. Any fundraising efforts that you're going to be announcing anytime soon, possibly for CapEx?
Yeah, we're still on track for spending our capex this year. We're already started our expansion in Bulgaria and in Mexico. We have a lot of forecasted projects that's coming into the Philippines, so this is good. And the utilization rate in China is happening. So I think from a funding perspective, we're looking at increasing some more liquidity into the market, and hopefully that would be, but internally we still have enough. Our cash balance is very strong. We're not heavily in debt, so we're financially very, very strong right now.
Okay, all right. So with that, we're gonna end the interview. Thank you so much for your time this morning.
Very good, Warren. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks. It's Mr. Arthur Tan, President of IMI.